Welcome to the afternoon. NFL free agency is hot, and it is ready. Tom Brady says goodbye, Eagles. Michael Buckheiser, and this is Just for Clicks, Raw and Uncut Sports Talk, coming at you here on the noon edition at the RTFSportsNetwork.com website, radio station, etc. If you guys are listening to me on Facebook, go ahead and hit that like button, and let's have an intelligent conversation in the comment section below. But today's show is more NFL-packed news because the NFL offseason officially starts here in about 3 or 4 hours. I believe it is 4 p.m. East Coast time is when the official league season starts, or the new year. I'm not sure how it's worded, but 4 p.m. East Coast time is when everything starts. We have news that is, you know, it is official but not official, if that makes sense. You know, you have people moving, people getting traded, free agency, yada, yada, yada. But all that's not official until, you know, a couple more hours here. But some of the biggest news to hit the airways as far as my mind is concerned right now, I guess. I could care less about Tom Brady, but Tom Brady's dominating the airlines. Tom Brady went to IG, to the social medias, and said, New England, it's been real, it's been fun, but deuces. So, I mean, like, of course, people are swarming. Where's Tom Brady going? Where is he going? Is he going to CD, or is he going to LA Chargers? Is he going to the Colts? Is he going to the Cowboys? Is he going to the Miami Dolphins? Is he going to the Detroit Lions? You guys, I love all the speculations, and I do think Tom Brady will test the waters in free agency. He will test the how does this team look? How does this team look? Can I win a Super Bowl here now? Are they going to give me what I want? Am I going to have weapons to where, you know, I can nickel and dime them down the field and hand the ball off? There are a lot of speculations that are going to happen, but I don't think Tom Brady is going to play anywhere else, guys. He is going to retire as a New England Patriot. Yeah, he is going to test the free market agency, yes. He is going to look at other teams. He's going to interview with other teams. He might even fly to California and go with the 49ers and Chargers and maybe even swing over to L.A. and talk to the Oakland Raiders and maybe the Colts. I don't know. But I don't think he is going to play anywhere else. I think Tom Brady is going to retire as a New England Patriot. And on maybe Friday's show, I will get some more insights. I'm trying to reach out to some Patriots insiders here and see exactly what is happening. Maybe we can get them on, maybe even as early as tomorrow's show. But with the news happening as fast as it is going, it's probably going to be late news by the time we get it out. But just some, before we get into the meat of today's show, I have Cody Cotner on to talk a little bit of Cowboys. We recorded this yesterday. And since then, you know, Byron Jones has signed with the Miami Dolphins. I don't have the deal off the top of my head right now, but it is rumored that he's going to go to Miami Dolphins. I also have an Eagles fan. Eagles wanted Byron Jones as well, but clearly that's not going to happen. Eagles have been active in free agency, though. They did sign a backup quarterback there, Nate Stubfield, to a one-year deal, making him pretty much. And welcome back to Just for Clicks, guys. This is Michael Buckheiser with live, raw, and uncut sports talk. Guys, we just got done talking about Gronk Gronkowski about making the move to WWE. And now we got to talk about the coronavirus. It is sweeping the nation. I just got an alert on my phone saying that the NCAA has now canceled all fans or banned all fans from coming to the tournament. Also saw that the College Basketball Invitational has been canceled as well. And I just saw that the Utah Jazz and forgot who they're playing, but the Utah Jazz postponed their game as well last night, obviously. So I have to bring a good friend on here, Matthew Lau. I'm sure you guys know his voice by now. He is all over the airways and whatnot. So, Matthew, first things first, man, how are you doing this today?
All right, man, I'm doing pretty good. I got a little daddy duty going on right now, so you know the struggle there. But really, other than that, just kind of, you know, kind of trying to be a sports fan, a doctor, a fortune, you know, a clinvariate, whatever the term is, to see the future because we don't know.
Right.
And really trying to, I guess, try to talk through, even though I wasn't one that made this decision, try to talk through the ups and downs and, you know, realize that this isn't, hopefully this is a short-sighted issue, but this answer, but we may never know the impacts that what you talked about will or will not have.
Yeah, what Matthew guys is referring to is the coronavirus and like how it is basically shutting down our world as we speak here. Last night, Donald Trump came on the air saying that we are suspending travel to Europe. As of Friday morning, I believe it was. We're no longer traveling to, like, China and all that good stuff. But we're here to talk about the aspect of the sports nature of this virus that is going on. That is, I mean, like, I have heard people say that this virus is nothing but more than a common flu. And the only reason why the death rate is higher for the coronavirus versus, you know, the flu is because 2 billion cases versus 100 cases, that type of thing. But we aren't here to really talk about the scientific and all that crap because that is for people much smarter than Matthew and myself.
Matthew, very much so.
What I really want to talk to you about is the cancellation of the fans going to the NCAA tournament. Me, myself, I had every intention of going to Kansas City tomorrow to watch the Big 12 tournament, but now I mean my Kansas State Wildcats are they played last night. Just a little inside note here, me and Matthew recorded this last night, so as we're recording this, I'm kind of trying to watch the game, and I don't even know if there's fans in the stands there. So Matthew, what kind of mindset do you think players have going into a game, into an empty arena, possibly playing for the tournament lives, because a team like Kansas State has to win the tournament, their conference tournament, to get into the March Madness. How do you think their mindset is going into a game like this, empty stadium?
You know, it might have a small impact with players, but I don't really think that will. I don't see anybody. I know LeBron made the joke, or he said it was a joke, or whatever.
That was not a joke. That was 100% serious.
He did damage control.
Right.
But there might be one player out there. I figure, like, someone along the lines of Anthony Edwards, if Georgia was to get in there. You know, somebody who the team probably doesn't stand much of a chance, but their team's in the tournament, maybe they could try to take some stand. But I think basketball players, they've been playing their entire season for this. And is there more of an anticlimactic way than just to say, okay, I'm done, especially for probably the top 30 teams in the country who, if this season's taught us anything, really anybody has a chance.
Right.
But so I think players are going to be fine. And one thing I'm kind of intrigued by is from that player aspect is – I often said that if your team wasn't in the tournament, this was kind of the year to enjoy it because everybody can beat everybody at the top. This just makes it a little bit more interesting. But what I will say is I don't think we're going to see any upsets this year because, you know, the years when Duke lost to Lehigh or Colgate or Florida Gulf Coast won it, you know, the team came out hot and that's going to happen. But what really pushed those teams over the edge, if you go back and watch, especially like UMBC when they beat Virginia, was when everyone in the stadium that wasn't a Virginia fan started rooting for the other team. Because, you know, UMBC probably only had 1,000 fans, but instantly 12,000 fans are rooting for them.
Right,
so exactly. That kind of – that's not going to happen. You know, obviously there's not going to be the fans. So that's not going to happen. So if you get a Colgate playing a Duke – Colgate may come out hot, hit the first three or four three-pointers and get his 5-6 point lead, but Duke's then going to take over. The only time this might have a negative impact, I guess, on the game is when you get two closely matched teams. And, you know, I think TV does a really good job. You've seen it with Kentucky. You've seen it with a lot of these top teams. They'll be down 10 to a really good team, and next thing you know, the lead's two. The crowd's going wild. Right. The players are fist bumping and waving their arms. That could – that might have a mental impact.
Yeah.
When you know, you're down 10, 5 minutes left in the game, you come down, you get a you hit a three-pointer, it's a seven-point game. You come back in, you get a layup, it's a five-point game. And then you come back down and hit another dagger for a three-point game, and you're just so pumped. The other team calls a timeout, and you look around, and it's just like five or six guys clapping for you.
Right.
Like, that could be a bit. But I think, you know, it's easy to look at this as kind of a fan and be like, oh, if I was a player, I wouldn't want to do it. But you haven't worked the last 6 months to 6 years of your life, depending on where you are in your college career, for this moment.
Yeah, you are 100% correct on that aspect. But being a college athlete myself, have been playing at the highest college level, at a Division I level to a JUCO level. I mean, there is a different type of atmosphere from walking in and seeing 100 people in the stands to seeing 20,000 people in the stands. It's just like you get the blood flowing and you feed off the atmosphere and et cetera. But that's all usually pre-game stuff. Usually once you get into the game, you do you. When you call a timeout, you know, you feel the crowd, you know. But in the actual aspect of the game, like, I don't think that will change too much.
Your thoughts? Right. Now, will the first two or three shots of the game be the most hideous things you've ever seen? Maybe. Because, like you said, there's nothing to get them pumped up. There's no crowd to get going. But for the most part, once you start going, right, it's competitor versus competitor.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's athlete v. athlete.
So we have talked a little bit about the player aspect of like, if it's going to affect their play. I think we're both kind of on agreement that it will affect maybe the start of the game, but like, once you get in the rhythm of the game, it'll be totally fine. But now let's talk about the economic impact that having these fans not in these stadiums is going to have, because, you know, stadiums that are in Cleveland and in Dayton, Kansas City, Chicago, and wherever else they like play, they bid to have these first, second round games, the Sweet 16 games, the Final Four, because of the economic impact it's going to have on their arena. You know, you're possibly losing tens to $20 million on this. Do you think this will affect the NCAA moving forward?
So I don't know, and I think that answer would require knowing more of the coronavirus and what that picture looks like. But the way this reminds me of the big version of, think back to like sales and Christmas shopping and Black Friday, and you find a great deal on something on Amazon, and it's going to cost you, you know, something that's $300 is going to cost you $100. So you order it. And then you get that email like a week later that says, oh, fresh out, but hey, we're going to send you your money back. Like, you didn't lose any money, but it's a hassle. You put a lot of time into it, and now you're not getting what you truly wanted. From my understanding, and I'm not 100% sure on this, that there's some kind of insurance that, since this has been caused, there's an insurance that will come into a play that will allow the NCAA to reimburse all the cities and the arenas who've made this bid. But they didn't do that because they wanted to show off their fancy arenas. They did that because they want you to come to Cleveland.
Right.
They want you to come to Kansas City. So will the NCAA be hurt? No. Will the person who owns whatever venues in Kansas City? From my understanding, not really. The person that gets hurt is the people who was going to work those events, is the bar down the street who couldn't wait for the influx of college kids so they could, you know, get their name on the map. It's the, you know, Barstool Sports, who's growing ever so big, has a game or has a bracket they've been doing the last couple of years, the best college bars. And a lot of times you get that exposure by coming to Cleveland or Indianapolis. That's not going to happen anymore.
Right.
Because, like, you might because you're from Kansas City, but if Kentucky gets the Indianapolis draw, I'm 2 hours from Indianapolis. I'm not going to go for any reason. So, those are the people that's going to have that impact, yeah. is the restaurants and the hotels and the people that was going to work those events. And that was, you know, because I actually have a family member who that's how they pay for their Christmas stuff is around October. They start doing a lot of monster truck shows. Okay. So they'll do like for 8 hours a day, they'll just bust hump, you know, in St. Louis or Chicago and just sell monster truck t-shirts. Well, there might be somebody who does that for March.
Yep, exactly.
That's not going to happen anymore.
Yeah.
There's no vendors. You probably don't need as much security. There might be a couple of cops in case somebody tries to sneak in, but security workers, popcorn, you know, all that stuff, beer sales, that's not going to happen.
Yeah, you are 100% correct on, like, on that, and I couldn't agree more. But, like, what about the average person here? You know, like, I bought tickets to the Big 12 tournament. I paid for my hotel. I paid for a flight. I'm not going to get reimbursed for any of that stuff. And for also, for like an example, I was supposed to go to the Arnold Classic up there in Ohio last week, and they will not reimburse me my hotel fee or my flight or anything like that. So to the average person such as myself that, you know, like I'm not rich by any means. So, so like it took a lot to save up to plan these events. And then now all of a sudden I'm not getting anything out of return. I'm never going to do like, I will not spend money to go to another NCAA tournament or a conference tournament because of this very reason.
That's a great point that I hadn't even considered, because here's the thing, like Ticketmaster and StubHub are typically pretty good at, hey, you had a bad experience, here's a refund. But this is every sporting event, right?
Right.
So now everybody who bought a conference tournament ticket, everybody who bought a Golden State Warrior ticket, everybody who bought an NBA ticket, everybody who bought people go through these StubHubs and these third market vendors. So that is a really good point. Because it's one thing to say, hey, this section had a bad experience. Let me give 30 tickets back.
Right.
It's another thing to do 30,000 tickets.
Yeah.
And I guess in this case, probably millions of tickets.
Exactly.
And if you look at everything that's been impacted,
yeah.
You got the entire Sweet Six, you got the entire tournament, you got a large portion of the conference tournaments, you got NBA games, you got entire postseason tournaments, which I don't know how big of ticket sales CBI had. But I imagine there's a couple thousand kids who's like not going to go now.
Yeah.
So I don't know how, if the businesses themselves stand up, or if it's CBI, if it's Ticketmaster and all those that have to bite the bullet, because I don't know how you would bounce back from that.
Yeah, because like I believe, you know, I'm probably going to be out right around $1,200 after it is all said and done with tickets and hotels,
right.
And flights and like all that stuff. And like, yes, I know Donald Trump, President Trump, came on last night and said, you know, we're in a economic hardship and like all that stuff. I don't know what that means for me. Like, does that mean like I say, hey, because of the coronavirus, I can't do this, this, and this. Give me my cash back. Like, I don't know how that all works out. And I will definitely share that information like as it comes, because, you know, I could use that $1,200 to go to Disney World or something else.
I was just agreeing so much stuff's going to go. And that's just assuming that this ends in the summer.
Right.
You know, people already, you know, I don't know how many college football and NFL season tickets have already started. I don't know how, you know, I've never really bought those. But let's just, you know, that's just best case scenario that by summer this is all hunky-dory and we've moved on to something else to be upset about. If this actually has any kind of staying power, the only thing I could think would save this if in 30 years we're talking to our kids and our grandkids and we're saying, believe it or not, Sonny, there was a time you actually went to the games.
Right. Yeah.
You know, because like you turn on the Super Bowl and it's played on just one big building and all there is a 100-yard field and 100 people in the stadium.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question for you. Do you think this is the beginning of the end of us going to games? Because let's be honest, the TV puts on a damn good production. You know, you get stats, you get storylines, you get, you know, $17 million Tony Romo telling you that a slant's coming. You know, it is
right.
they put on a damn good show. So do you think this is the beginning of the end of the, let's say, average sports fan, you know, going to games anymore?
You know, I'm not a big conspiracy theorist. You know, people say, oh, there's this is that. And I don't really buy that because, you know, I think life just stinks sometimes. Sometimes right. bad things just happen in the world and then you just got to be. But I do think Americans especially are very opportunistic. And there, I bet there's somebody out there that said, like, for example, one thing that's caught a lot of flack, you know, over the years is media members busting into the locker room immediately after a loss and being in a player's face.
Right.
If you noticed, all the major sports events came out in solidarity and said, hey, we're knocking that off for now.
Yeah, but look at the XFL. They are striving with that right now.
Right. Don't be surprised if that never comes back. Even after coronavirus becomes a joke and whatever, you know, however long, maybe it, whatever.
Right.
Don't be surprised if the major leagues that can deal without it never let media back in the locker room. And, you know, don't be surprised if, you know, if last year or maybe even this year is the last time that the Final Four takes effect in these huge domes. Because even though it was cool at a time, you go back and watch some of these Final Four games, and you can see the empty seats, and it has nothing to do with being a bad performance.
Right.
It's you're playing a basketball game in a football stadium.
Right.
Well, and these football stadiums are just getting bigger.
Right. And so that, and they put, you know, 15,000 seats on the actual field itself, you know, because they,
right.
Because the basketball court's only like, what, 20 yards long or something.
Yeah.
To
yeah.
That
a
effect.
Very so, small fraction right. of the football field. So don't be surprised if they don't use this as an opportunity to start getting back in maybe some of these nicer, like the Golden State Warriors, you know, they got this super right. nice NBA stadium. So even after all this blows over, you know, hoping it does, yeah, don't be surprised if we don't get to a stage, a part where we're done with these super mega stadiums, that these are over, because that's got to be expensive. And let's be honest, if you can trim that number that goes to the Final Four down to about 15,000, what's everybody else doing?
Yeah,
they're sitting with that, but everybody else is sitting at home, right?
Right.
Bigger TV contracts, because now you've got more viewers.
I see where you're going with that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and that's where, let's be real, that's where all these contracts come from. Everybody's like, oh, I'm the ticket owner, you owe me. No. It's like you said, it's CBS paying Tony Romo $17 million because CBS just paid NFL billions for their rights.
Right.
So, look, I know the guy sitting in row 12 eating a hot dog, drinking a $12 beer, says, hey, you're playing for me. No, they're playing for me and you sitting at home watching
right,
the McDonald's
right,
ad.
Right. Yeah, me.
So don't be surprised. Don't be surprised. Even though I don't think nothing too crazy will happen, don't be surprised if people who've already been saying, hey, man, it cost us a lot of money to rent out Jerry World and we only use half of it.
Right. Well,
you know,
or we rented out Jerry World for, you know, 15 camera people to like show up to.
Right.
But
yeah. And if you look, go back and I encourage listeners to go look at that Final Four in Dallas. The court is a fraction of the size of that big OTV.
Yeah.
So if you ever want to feel like space is being wasted, go look at that Final Four.
Right. Well, like I remember seeing some pictures where the TV screen looked bigger than the basketball court. Like it was mind blowing.
Yeah. Well, just like normal stadiums, just like the Indianapolis Colts when the Final Four is in Indianapolis, that stadium that the Colts have is bigger than the basketball court.
Right.
So yeah, you're absolutely going to see that. So I just, like I said, I'm not saying that this is all some big hoopla. I'm just saying, don't be surprised if somebody somewhere doesn't say, hey, you know, let's pretend we make it through this and everything's hunky-dory and we crown a championship. Don't be surprised if next Final Four or whenever the contract's up again, they're like, hey, remember that 2020? That did all right.
Yeah.
You know, we still had millions of viewers and nobody came to the game.
Well, actually,
I think the next Final Four can be in Indianapolis's basketball stadium.
I mean, actually, if you think about this, let's say 50,000 people are going to these games. That's probably 50,000 more people they're going to get viewing the game, you know. So TV ratings are probably going to skyrocket 100%. and you're going to get the average passive person like, oh, they don't have any fans. I wonder how this looks. I wonder how this sounds. So, I mean, you're going to double, maybe even triple the viewership.
I'm very excited. Yeah. I don't want to say excited to see it because I think I'm more concerned of the bigger picture.
Yeah.
But I'm very intrigued of how this is going to look.
Yeah. Especially, it's kind of scary, to be honest with you.
But, like, if you look at the numbers since they started going to these huge godlike football stadiums, the shooting's just atrocious because you're used to shooting in a basketball stadium.
Right.
And next thing you know, you have nothing to look at.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think – and these basketball stadiums are getting nice. Like I said, the Warriors.
Yeah.
I know the Clippers are talking about building something new. I don't think there's really any reason that we have to stick them in, you know, the Falcons stadium or the Cowboys stadium. I think we're getting to a place where we can get back to just playing in Plano Indianapolis Fieldhouse.
Yeah. I mean, I've been there. It's a fairly nice place, but, I mean, I wouldn't want to have a Final Four there. But I digress on that point.
I think you can – my last point on that, I think that's – if you started going in that direction, I think there's some changes you could make and you could implement into future basketball stadiums to where it is a very nice feeling.
Right, yeah, yeah. I didn't want to sound condescending or
right, no, absolutely.
But,
because, I mean, teams don't want to do it because no one does anymore. You start putting Final Fours back in NBA stadiums, people are going to take respect with it again.
Or, like, even nice college basketball season. On my bucket list to go to a college like arena is the Syracuse place. I mean, I would love to go there to experience a game. Or
which ironically is a football stadium. What? But yeah, I mean, Fog Allen's good. I mean, if you want more class, much as I hate to say it as a Kentucky fan, Yum Center's amazing.
Yeah, Yum Center sees a lot of people. Yes.
And I'll be honest with you, you know, I get it about history and stuff. But have you been, like, Rupp Arena is getting some work, but it still needs some more.
Yeah.
If you've been to an Indiana Hoosiers game, that stadium needs some upkeep.
But
if you started putting Final Fours back.
Love that stadium.
Maybe that's the thing. But if you start putting Final Fours back in the colleges, I think teams would start keeping up with themselves some more.
Right. Yeah. So I want to ask you a couple more questions here. And it all kind of evolves around this whole corona thing virus that is happening. So earlier in the week, Ivy League has, you know, said we're not going to play any postseason tournaments, and they have canceled all their spring sports as well, baseball, track, et cetera. Mm-hmm. So let me ask you this question. Let's say the SEC canceled the postseason tournament, and you had a team like a Mississippi State that is, you know, they come on hot pretty, you know, pretty late, and they have a good opportunity to make a run for the conference tournament championship, giving a automatic bid. But then the SEC cancels the tournament. If you are a Mississippi State fan, how would you feel about that?
I mean, you'd be upset, obviously, but I think also you just – I mean, this move, like, so let me, the Mississippi State fan, you'd be upset. Because of the fan base, especially in college basketball where the hot team matters, you want to think everything matters, right? Like, you want to think Mississippi State or Kansas State even, you know, this is your all's UConn team from 2015 or whatever. So, but this move kind of showed me that the NCAA doesn't care about these dreams you have.
Well,
you know,
like, I would say the Ivy League, I mean, because it come from the Ivy League, I mean, like, let's say it would have come from, like, a mid-major conference like the AAC, you know, like, say if it came from, like, a mid-major conference and like, your team that wins the tournament gets into the NCAA tournament, like, how would you feel then?
I'm wanting to look at something real quick, but I will answer your question. I think you have to look at the parties involved with Harvard and those Ivy League schools. The celebrities aren't the athletes. The celebrities are the lawyers and the future business people.
Exactly. That's why I said a mid-major.
Those people are like, hey, don't get us sued, you know?
Right.
But also, if I'm not mistaken, I believe, like, the Ivy League was, like, the last – conference to get an actual postseason tournament.
Oh, really?
And that was like 2 years ago, and I think they didn't even want it. So if they were like, because I think what happened was for so many years, the regular season best team just got into the tournament. So if you have a conference that already didn't want to have a postseason tournament, I don't think it's going to take a lot to convince them to get rid of the postseason tournament.
I see what you're saying.
One thing I'm looking into, and I apologize, Mike, I don't want to sound distant, is
you're out late.
It's looking, I'm seeing reports that the NBA season might have been canceled.
The NBA season?
Yeah. So.
Oh, crap. Okay.
So see if you can.
I mean, like, I saw they post the last night they, yes, I saw NBA suspends regular season and will use hiatus to determine next steps. Breaking news at 9:40 p.m. when we're recording this. So literally just came across my phone four minutes ago. So, I mean, so does this mean that the NCAA has to cancel their tournament as well to follow suit?
That only reason I'm going to say no, and maybe I'm wishful thinking, is that there's only six. Now, this may, though, they may get rid of the conference tournaments.
Well, K-State's playing right now, so.
Well, they may just say tomorrow's done. Right. Like, okay. Today, it's done. I don't even know, but the tournament's just six more games.
Right.
At three more venues. And you could really, you would have to think on your feet, and I don't even know if the NCAA would care enough, but they might be like, we're having all this on two different venues or four different venues, and you just eliminate travel. Like, you, I don't know how that would happen so quick.
Would you
and
cut that's it what down makes to 16 teams? Just make it the Sweet 16, Elite 8?
Maybe 32.
Yeah.
Maybe, I don't know. Then, you know, because we've seen, you talk about Mississippi State fans being mad in that like, scenario you made up. Imagine being a team that's not in the top 16.
Yeah, or, like, I mean, this is all just baffling to me just because of, like, I've heard reports of the coronavirus is just like a mild flu. I mean, like, people like you and myself will be perfectly fine if we wash our freaking hands. But, I mean, like, the people that are compromised, you know, that have underlying illnesses and older people are the ones that are, you know, kind of need to watch out, just like they need to watch out for the flu. So, like,
I think what they're afraid of is it's, and I don't really know, like I said, I don't want to get too deep into it because I'm not a, you know, by no means am I a doctor, a scientist, anything like that.
Right.
I think from everything I've been able to kind of take away from it and just mildly consuming, like, the content that's been thrown at me is that, best case scenario, it's the flu, but we don't know what the worst case scenario is. And I know that the numbers of the death are higher and people die, and death is obviously the worst case.
Yeah.
But with flu, we kind of know that, hey, you did this, we gave you this vaccine, the worst still happened, okay.
Yeah.
But like, you,
I get what you're saying.
I think,
I get what you're saying.
Like, you don't really know, and I'm hearing these reports, and I haven't had a chance to look into it, about, like, Turkey and all these other countries having, like, these spikes are just rising. Like, I hate to make light of this situation by comparison, but you don't know that in 2 weeks the original 10,000 people in China that was hit don't turn into the next Walking Dead. You know, I'm not saying that would happen, but you know what I'm saying? You
right,
don't know
yeah.
that there's not a strand.
I get what you're saying, yeah.
Because apparently, if you look at the Lysol can, this, if you've seen the meme, this has been a disease. It's been around.
Well, it is different strands, just like the flu, like every year. Like,
right, that's what I'm saying.
Get the bird flu, get the N1H, like
exactly.
Like H1,
so
you know, whatever.
It's back in a different strand,
yeah.
But we don't know anything about it. So, I mean, could this be an overreact? Sure. But would it be equally as naive to just assume, almost like in a movie where you're like, oh, that villain's dead, and then he actually raises up to attack? I think it's equally to assume, it's equally as reckless to kind of assume that once it's gone, it's gone.
So we don't know. Let me ask you this. Would you rather have an overreaction just like this of canceling all major events, no sporting events, no concerts, but you're able to go to work still? I mean, like, this is the one thing that's irritating me the most is that, you know, I get to go to work in 4 hours, you know, but yet I spent $1,200 to go to Kansas City to watch a basketball game that I can't go to because of the same exact reason, but I have to go to work. I don't know. Here's my thing.
All your sports, all your non-sports fans, or all your sports nitpickers, the people that like pick, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, like, oh, right. He makes so much money for playing a ball game. Well, here you go. The reason the reason me, the reason Billy Bob has to go to work is because at the end of the day, our $15, $20 an hour job is still very important.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, LeBron James doesn't play a basketball game the rest of the year, the world will still continue.
Yeah.
I mean, it sucks not watching sports. But if the entire assembly lines of these intricate factories that create things that we all rely on, if they send everybody home for a month, just imagine what would happen if for 14 days nobody worked. There'd be no production, no producing,
no more toilet paper. Anything. Oh, wait, that's already done.
right. So, great point. So, the guy who works at Charmin, who every day at work's like, oh, I can't believe he gets paid $10 million to dribble a basketball.
Right.
Well, here's your time to shine. Because we can't send you home for 2 months because we need more toilet paper. LeBron. Yeah.
Well, but like me, like so I don't want to get into like a political debate or like anything.
Understandable.
Or like act like I'm, you know, a scientist or a doctor. But yet, wouldn't it be more, you know, contagious to go to work if because if I don't go to work, I don't get paid. And they're saying, if you feel bad, if you got a fever, stay home. Okay, then I get fired because I called in 2 days in a row. But then I got to go to work to make that Charmin toilet paper. I'm coughing and sneezing on the freshly packaged toilet paper, getting ready to send out to healthy people that are going to put it over their mouth, thinking it's just as good as a mask. So,
right. Yeah. I mean, I get that. And like I said, I know that there are each states are talking about doing things. And like I said, I definitely don't want to go that political route. But I do think the mindset is that let's just assume me and you work next to each other.
Yeah.
That me and you don't have it. But me and you come home and we go to work. And we come home and we go to work. I think what they're trying to eliminate, if you notice, is large crowds of more than 1,000 people. And what do sports, concerts, all these events have in common?
Rubbing elbows.
The
sweating,
people who are watching is flying all over the country.
Right.
I get what you're saying. Right. Because, so when you go watch a concert, that person probably was in Vegas a week ago, in Seattle 2 weeks ago, in Kansas City 2 days ago, and in Indianapolis last night.
Right.
So I think that's kind of what that is. I'll be honest with you. I'm hoping. I guess the reason the NCAA one concerns me the most is because I think my original point was the NCAA is right here on us, and they only got 6 more games.
Right.
Whereas the NBA had still 30 games left and an entire playoff that takes 3 months.
Yeah.
So maybe that's the thought.
Well, and the NBA can, you know, they can kind of burden this little, you know, not playing for a couple of months because that's a billion. Me, of course, the NCAA is a $1 billion operation as as well. But March Madness is where they make a bulk of their money.
Right. And we've seen this before. I mean, 1999, it wasn't coronavirus related by any means. But I mean, we had a lockout. We had a 50 game season.
Right.
So it was just a little laid out a little different. So I could see this still being a thing. I think the only reason the NCAA kind of makes me a little nervous, and I just really, because I really love March Madness, and it's such a great time, is that that's really the only sport that you can't be overreactionary with and it not have a big downside. Because, like you, kind of to your point, if the NBA, because the message said the NBA suspends operations.
Right.
Well, that could mean by April 30th, they're back at it.
That could be next week, they're back at it too. So
March, the NCAA tournament doesn't have that luxury.
Right.
Even people are like, well, you could push it back. Well, let's say it takes June.
Right.
Now you got people trying to go pro. You got seniors who's trying to graduate and start their new career. You got people wanting to transfer and enroll in different schools. You got new kids wanting to get ready to get on campus.
Let me cut you off real quick though, but let's talk about that. Let's say the NCAA doesn't have the March Madness tournament. There are people that are banking their lives of over the next 5 weeks, you know, let's say we didn't have March Madness back when Steph Curry was drafted into the NBA. Would have Steph Curry gone to the NBA? Would John Morant be a number or a number two overall pick like last year? I see what you're saying about the NCAA tournament. Right. How we don't have that luxury. If they cancel it, there could be kids' futures ruined. Because of this.
I get it. But I think the takeaway that I think a lot of people need to step back and really take is we're kind of spoiled. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I'm not being like a boomer and saying, oh, spoiled kids. We just grown accustomed to thinking certain things aren't going to happen. Like, and I know it's a different time, but remember, like, you look in history books and you're like, oh, there was no Final Four or there was no, like, championship game during the Great Depression, or there was no cars, there was no Mustang made during this certain year because all the metal was sent overseas. And like I said, I know it's a different time and an entirely different economy. There's no 2013
championship because Louisville cheated.
There you go. I know it feels weird because it's never happened in our lifetime. But I could see that being, or talking to our grandkids and being like, and watching a 30 for 30, whatever comes out then of the 2020, the title that never existed.
Right.
I could see that. You'd like to think it would never happen because it really hasn't. But things like this has happened in the world. And in the grand scheme of things, yes, it does mess up that kid's future. Yes, this is that, I think Kimball Walker is a great example. Made an entire career off the postseason, whether it be the Big East or the NCAA tournament. So, yes, will that take a hit? Yes. But, it would not shock me if this goes down to that, Dad, why in 1999 did the Spurs only win 30 games?
Right.
Well, there's only a 50-game season.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I really like your perspective on a positive outlook, and I'm trying not to be a Debbie Downer on the whole situation, but I guess I'm just a little bit bitter by wasting $1,200 to go do that kind of stuff.
No, not, but now granted, I didn't waste $1,200, so maybe that that helps me out there. But I think it's just one of those ones where we've always joked about this on other podcasts. How creative I try to get. I'm the one that wants the tournaments to go, I want the Final Four to be best 2 out of 3.
Right.
I want it to go to 96 teams. I always have these crazy thoughts. So I've thought of the downside too.
Crazy
it's just not
thought.
As fun to talk about.
Here's a crazy thought.
I've thought about what happens.
Top 4 teams. Boom.
Right. I've thought about crazy things. That what happens if college basketball doesn't adapt and the G League takes over and college basketball goes away? It's just one of those things where you look throughout history, things that people are like, oh, that'll never happen. They kind of have.
Yeah.
There's sports that have been more important. Look, baseball. I know it's still around and it's still doing things, but there was a time that baseball was king. And now, it kind of falls behind. Hockey's kind of catching it. So I think it would be kind of naive to think that college basketball could never, struggle, or the NFL could never go away for head concussion purposes. So I think obviously I was never like, hey, I bet one year there's going to be a virus that makes all sports shut down for 6 months. I never thought of that.
No.
But I guess when it comes to the things that are quote unquote traditional, I'm okay with change. I just don't want it to be this. And I guess I was so afraid that they were going to cancel the NCAA tournament when they came out and said the fans were gone. I was like, sweet. We met in the middle, but
yeah, now I feel like it is just a matter of time. If the NBA is suspended their season, I just saw that the Major League Baseball has suspended spring training now as well. It is just a matter of time before NCAA is forced to follow suit, unfortunately.
So my thoughts on it is, and I know we'll probably wrap this up. This is my thoughts and my hopes. I think the NBA will be all right. It'll just be weird. I think there'll just be a big gap and it'll come back and there'll probably be 10 games left and we'll just go into the playoffs. And, because the NBA's really, you can talk about seeding, but let's be honest, it's going to be Lakers, Clippers, Celtics, Sixers. That's the 4 teams that kind of matter. So it's not really that big a deal. Baseball's still far enough away. And you got 162 games. Football, they're still arguing over how many games. The one that concerns me short term is the college basketball. And I don't know if they can pull a new stadium system out there. I don't know if they can say, hey, we're going to Atlanta And, you know, on a side note, have you ever seen like the AAU tournaments where there's just like five basketball courts and everybody's playing at once?
Right.
Could they do that in Atlanta? Could they just set up four basketball courts? Yeah. There's no fans anyway. Just set up four basketball courts and each region play. I don't know. I don't know. The one sport that I think would take a hit and be gone, it's not really a sport, is the XFL. The XFL, I felt like, put all their money on this year. And if they had to suspend operations, they would never come back.
Yeah.
Because it's just not been profitable enough.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely another topic for another day here.
Definitely.
Unfortunately, we're getting at the time restraint here. So, Matthew, thank you for coming on. And like, if you guys are hearing this and we're kind of, like, all over the place, it is because Matthew and myself recorded this the day before you guys are hearing it. So the news is kind of coming at us quick and fast. I mean, right before we came on air, Trump was speaking to the nation about suspending flights and, like, all that stuff. And then, you know, Matthew got the notification on his phone. I got the notification on my phone. So we're kind of just spitballing ideas, you know, because, you know, this is definitely raw and uncut right now. 100%.
And, I mean, I imagine if you turn it on ESPN, even though it's probably a little more organized because it's a million-dollar industry,
right?
They're struggling for things to talk about. They're probably pulling Stephen A. Smith out of the middle of the night and saying, hey, tell us. And they're probably just calling people to say, come on and talk because, you know, you had
– do it from home because they don't want you to bring the coronavirus into ESPN, though.
Right. Can you talk from a distance? But, all right, Mike, thanks for having me on. I'd love to come on sometime a little later in March to see where we're at with the tournament. Is the tournament all hands on deck as planned?
Yeah.
Are they making maneuvers to change, or is it outright gone?
Yeah, man. Well, so, we can definitely have you on. Next week is a little bit of dicey for me because my little man number two is scheduled to be here. So we'll definitely work you in as we can. Thank you very much, guys.
All right, man.
That's going to be it for today's show. Thank you for joining us. Join me, Michael Buckheiser, with Just for Clicks. Join me tomorrow at noon on rtssportsnetwork.com. Have a great day, guys. And how you doing today, Mike?
Doing well. How are you?
Man, it is awesome. All the sports world has not been shut down because of the coronavirus. Just 95% of it. So NFL free agency is obviously still happening here. And I know you couldn't be much more excited about it being a Minnesota Vikings fan, right?
Well, I don't know if I'd go that far.
Well, it's the only sports that we have right now. And NFL free agency is kicking off with a bang here. And you are a Minnesota Vikings fan, diehard. So first thing I got to ask you, man, is the Kirk Cousins 2-year extension worth $66 million, giving him a 3-year $96 million left on his contract. If you were the owner/GM of the Minnesota Vikings, would you have signed Kirk Cousins to this deal?
I think part of it is they had to. You know, they've made two moves already today. They franchise tagged Anthony Harris for $12.7 million. They signed C.J. Ham to a 4-year $12 million. We did have about $20 million in cap space by releasing Linval Joseph and Xavier Rhodes. So we couldn't have necessarily done both of those today without the restructure. You know, counting next year's salary from Cousins' old deal, which was, like you said, $96 million, with the $61 guaranteed at signing, you know, he gets $35 million guaranteed for injury, but the deal converts to a fully guaranteed beginning next year. You know, so they're probably not going to cut him after one season and still owe him $61 million. So it's effectively still a fully guaranteed contract.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, but the question has to arise here is, can the Vikings win with Kirk Cousins? Yes, I know they went 10-6 last year, finishing second in the division. But long term, for the next 3 years, let's consider that long term, are the Minnesota Vikings Super Bowl contenders with Kirk Cousins as their quarterback?
Well, we're going to be a much different team this year. I think we did prove last year by going into New Orleans and beating the Saints in a playoff game that we can win with him, yes. But it really depends on, you know, fortifying our offensive line. You know, he was an MVP candidate last year, you know, for a short amount of time. He's a really good quarterback when he has time. But in the NFL, as we can see, that doesn't rarely happen. So I guess we'll see. Our defense is going to be a full, you know, kind of revamp D. So I don't know if we'll be a top five, top 10 defense this year. It's going to be a different year from a Vikings fan.
Yeah, you mentioned earlier in our conversation here that they did release Xavier Zode, Rhodes. I should say, me being a Kansas City Chiefs fan, when they released Eric Perry, I was heartbroken, upset, kind of just mad at the world. How do you feel like about the Vikings releasing him?
Oh, I love it. The roads are open now. So you know, I was a huge Xavier fan. You know, early on, I'm a Florida State guy. So when we drafted him, you know, he was one of the best cornerbacks in the league, but he's fallen off. He's not the same player that he once was. He's getting penalized, you know, one of the most out of any cornerback in the league. And, you know, I was extremely happy and not surprised that we got rid of him.
Do you think they could have like signed and traded him and got something out of him, or just flat out release him was the best option?
No, release was the best option, again, because with the little amount of cap space that the Vikings have, by releasing him and Linval, we have the opportunity to go after those players and re-sign them to a new deal if other teams don't go after them, which I would assume they will. But as far as the Vikings are concerned, we're done.
Yeah, so as far as free agency goes, you know, free agency is going to be coming in full swing here in about roughly 24 hours, Wednesday at 4 p.m., I think, is when free agency officially starts in the NFL and the offseason really gets underway, and like all the speculations that we see can be official. What do the Vikings, like, what is their biggest need, you think, in free agency? Do they go after a safety? Do they go after some linemen, some wide receivers? Like, what is their biggest needs in the Minnesota Viking land?
Well, as you mentioned, safety was a big need, but with franchise taking Anthony Harris, you know, I believe 12.75 mil with Harry the Hitman is at 10 mil this year. So we're at, you know, 22.75 million in safeties, which is pretty expensive. Right. But with no cornerbacks really going to be on roster besides some late round picks from last year and such, I could see that. I don't see the Vikings having a lot of money to play around with in free agency. It's definitely going to be probably a third wave type deal and getting some people to smaller contracts. We'll see as free agency moves forward how much availability and cap space we're going to have. Offensive line is obviously a huge need. I think a lot of that Rick Spielman addresses in this coming up draft. He's been great in the past with drafting players. Brian O'Neill was a second round pick a couple years ago, who's our starting right tackle. I think we do have some good draft picks to be able to find some starters. Last year we drafted a guy at guard, you know, of course I forget his name right now, who I think is going to be fighting for a starting role. So offensive line is huge. You know, this draft is going to be a big one for us because we're losing a lot of big name players for the Vikings this year.
So let's kind of fast forward to the draft here. Who do you think, like, what is the biggest position you guys have to do well in the draft this year? Is it on the offensive side or the defensive side to like start out here? What's your biggest draft needs?
Well, I think we're going to probably get a cornerback at some point, if not two. If history repeats itself, you know, Mike Zimmer's a wizard when it comes to working with these guys. We can get a cornerback in the sixth, seventh round, even an undrafted free agent, and really mold them. The trouble is we don't have a lot of time to work with these guys. We need them to compete right away. You know, I've been saying all along, even with the signing of Kirk Cousins, I really want to go after a quarterback in the second or third round. Jalen Hurts, I've really been pushing for. Obviously the Vikings don't listen to me. I think he would be great even sitting for a couple years. You know, the thing with the Cousins deal, and this I don't believe will happen, but it is something to keep your eye out on. The Niners can get rid of Jimmy G. His salary isn't guaranteed until April 1st. If he's released prior to June 1st, they'd save $22.4 million in cap. And Kyle Shanahan is obsessed with Kirk Cousins. I mean, he was going after him hard even after they got Jimmy G.
Right.
and, you know, would give a limb to have him on the team. Now, do I know if that'll happen or not? No, but I think getting this contract extension done with Cousins and having, you know, a contract in hand that's more than 1 year is easier to be able to trade him, you know, so it wouldn't be a straight up for Jimmy G. They could just release him altogether and you know, save in cap relief, and then the Vikings could go young at quarterback and kind of go from there, you know. So we'll see, I guess. But I still think they should get a quarterback of the future now, whether that's to sit behind him for a couple years. And a guy like Jalen Hurts is a proven winner and a gamer, and I'd love to have him in purple.
Yeah, I was listening to the Twist, I believe it was a couple weeks ago, when, like, you and your two other co-hosts were kind of really going in on this. I forget the Packers guy's name, but he was not.
Yeah, Green Bay Greg.
Yeah, he was not sold on Kirk Cousins whatsoever. So, do you think Jalen Hurts will fall to the Vikings in like a second round pick, or do you have to jump up and take him in the first round?
Well, I've said I'd like to take him in the first. I don't see them doing that now, you know, mostly because you get that fifth-year option, and especially if you're going to have him sit behind Kirk for a couple years, you get that option. He'll be starting by then, and then you work out a new contract moving forward. I know Green Bay Greg is dancing in his cheese head and his kilt right now because he's loving this contract and probably can't wait till our show starts, you know, to get into it. But again, it's something that we had to do. Originally, I didn't think we needed to do, but as stuff has unfolded today and some of the franchise tag and the CJ Ham, which is a quiet signing, but a good one for the Minnesota Vikings. It just, you know, that freed up $10 million in cap space with the restructure of his contract.
Yeah. Plus the additional $10 million from the CBA as well, added to the salary cap as well. So you got a little bit extra money to play with there as well, which is, I'm sure, yep, for you is exciting. And as most teams across the team or across the league, it is exciting. That means they can pay their quarterbacks $140 million instead of $130 million. But I digress on that a little bit. So I am looking at the opponents for the 2020 season for the Minnesota Vikings. I mean, you obviously play your division foes home and away, but like at home here, you got the Jacksonville Jaguars, the Titans, Falcons, Panthers, and Cowboys. And then on the road, you got the Texans, Colts, Seahawks, Buccaneers, and then the Seahawks as well. You guys went 10-6 last year. Like, I know this is way too early. What do you see your schedule or your record being next year?
Oh, probably more. Let's run through them game by game, and I'll give you a win-loss.
Okay, so we'll start with the home schedule here. You have the Bears at home.
Win.
Lions.
Win.
Packers.
At home, win.
Jacksonville Jaguars. Yeah, these are all at home for the first eight. Jacksonville Jaguars.
Win.
Titans.
Win.
Falcons.
Win.
Panthers.
Win.
Dallas Cowboys.
We'll go loss. We'll go 7-1 at home.
7-1 at home.
And I think we can beat them because we did beat them at their home last year. Right. But
yeah, the Cowboys were going to be a totally different team, though. I had them going 13-3 last year in the preseason. Clearly that did not happen. They're going to be a below 500 team this year, I think. So that'd be kind of an upset. If they
have a lot of weapons, but we're a very much different team at home than we are away.
Right.
And that's not a horrible, you know, whether it's a loss to the, I hate to say it, but the Packers or, you know, it gives me some wiggle room. But I think we have a strong home record next year. So I'd take a 7-1 at home.
Just as long as none of those games are on primetime, you guys will be A-okay.
Oh, yeah.
Now, looking at the opponents on the road here, you had the Bears on the road.
Yep. So 8-1.
Lions.
9-1.
Packers.
We'll go 9-2.
Okay. So one loss in division. That is a stretch going from 10-6, second in division last year now.
Yeah, well, we're looking at the Bears possibly signing Teddy Bridgewater, so they're not getting, you know, much of an upgrade at quarterback. They're not going to be the same team. You know, I can easily say that I think we'll take both games from Detroit and Chicago.
Okay, well, let's touch on the Detroit Lions here like a little bit. Yes, you should hate the Detroit Lions being a division foe there. Should the Lions trade Matthew Stafford and get a quarterback like Jalen Hurts?
Well, I think they could probably get him regardless of trading Stafford. I know there was rumblings about a month ago of them possibly doing it. I don't think they'll get rid of him. I think they'll also be in a position like the Vikings where they could, you know, with the second round pick. I don't know if they would reach as far as a first round pick. Stafford's probably got three to 5 years left, depending on his health.
Right.
You know, I sure hope they don't get Jalen Hurts because that's who I'm trying to get.
Right. So right now you have your team going about 8-2, if I'm not mistaken.
9-2, I believe.
9-2, okay. So next up you have the Houston Texans on the road.
You know, I probably would have gave that to the Texans, but it looks like they've already made a deal today that makes their team worse. So I'm probably going to take the Vikings.
For Johnson, which is a big trade there. So then you got
unbelievable.
Yeah. I mean, Hopkins must have not have been happy there. I mean, you do not let a talent like that go for that for a running back. So, but
he's a top five receiver for a running back who could barely crack the roster in Arizona. Right. So, yeah.
But whatever. We digress on that one a little bit. Indianapolis Colts.
Ooh, they're a tough. I'm going to take a loss there. I think they probably get Phillip Rivers. I think we absolutely can beat them, but they have a tough defense. We'll just take a loss there.
The Colts at home are tough, period. I don't care if you're the Super Bowl champs or not. Like they're tough. Next up, you have the Saints on the road as well.
We're going to lose there, too.
And Buccaneers?
Win.
And then Seahawks?
Loss.
So you have about 11-5 record, if my math is correct there. Give or take. So better than last season, you know, a game better. I mean, losing only one game in the division will give you that division championship, so automatic playoff bid there. So now let's say the playoffs do expand to 7 teams like they are discussing here. Do the Vikings get a first-round bye in the playoffs?
Well, what's different with the new CBA is only 2 teams are going to get buys rather than 4. So I don't think the Vikings are going to end up with the best record in the NFC and be able to get that bye. Even if we are division winners, it's going to be best record in the NFC. And I don't think 11-5 is probably going to be good enough for a bye.
Just off the top of your head, what do you think the NFC best record win loss record is going to be? 12-4, 13-3?
Yeah, I'd probably say 13-3. I think the Niners have a good shot at, you know, being pretty much the same team, if not even a little bit better. That defense is stacked, and I don't see them digressing much at all. You know, the Saints, there's a ton of teams that could potentially do that. But, yeah, I'd probably say 13-3 is going to get that bye. Whoever that team may be.
Yeah, I mean, that's been kind of the trend the last couple of years, so I definitely concur with that 100%. So, first things first, what are your thoughts on expanding to 7 teams in the playoffs per division? Do you think that's better? Worse?
You know, the 17 game is going to be, you know, it's happening in the next, you know, could be next year, could be 2023. We're going to see how they kind of figure out what they do about that. I think the players made the right choice in getting the CBA done. Now we're done till 2030. A lot of good things happened for them in that. But we'll see how the expanded. I do like the additional teams in the playoffs. The buys are what's tricky. It's nice to have 2 teams coming out of each, you know, NFC and AFC having a bye. I know the Packers loved that last year, the Putzes. And so that's going to be interesting. It'll be weird, but, you know, it should be exciting. The NFL is, you know, the best sport in the world, and more of it can't hurt.
Yeah, I mean, really what I think the overall goal for this is to allowing the extra team into the playoffs is to prevent from teams basically not playing the last 2 weeks of the season like the Baltimore Ravens did like last year, and then the Saints didn't, you know, play their final game like of the season. Like they basically just want teams to play out the full 16-game season, battling for that number one overall seed. So that's where I think the ultimate goal is to that. And of course, you know, allowing an extra team into the playoffs gives you that extra game, extra fan bases. So I mean, all eyes on the NFL at the end of the day.
Well, exactly. And now that there's only one bye, you know, they are going to be playing every game trying to get the best record to get that bye, because that's a huge advantage in the playoffs.
Yeah, definitely 100%. So, Mike, thank you for joining us here on Just for Clicks here this afternoon. Guys, at rtfsportsnetwork.com is where you are listening to us right now. Mike, where can people find Twist at?
TwistSportsTalk.com, RTFSportsNetwork.com, all our social media platforms. You can find us at Twist Sports Talk.
All right, Mike. Thank you for joining me for this afternoon. Guys, we'll be right back after this break.